I once read that motivation is needed for hard work and hard work is needed for success. Success gives us more motivation and the loop goes on. In terms of CP, success is like an increase in your rating because that's how you can measure how good you're doing. But there are a lot of people who are stuck in the same rating range for a long time and it's really demotivating for them. So if you're one of them, you're in the right video right now. And today I'm going to tell you two very easy tricks that will help you increase your ratings in just a short amount of time, and they are very effective. I know this because I've used them in my own journey, and I hope that these will be helpful to you. So let's get right into it. Number one, high problem tags from code forces. So tags are big hints. These are hints that you shouldn't have in the first place. When you're attempting a problem in a contest, you cannot see the tags. Like, you cannot know that this problem belongs to the DP tag or to the graph tag. So whenever you know the tag of a problem, your thinking process gets very limited. And if you know that the problem belongs to the DP tag, you will only think in the DP direction. And that's a big hint. And you do not want to know that before solving the problem. So to make your practice more efficient, you should hide the tag. And to do this, go to the code forces settings and check the option hide tags for unsolved problems. After this, you won't be able to see the tags for problems that you haven't already solved. While you're solving a problem, if you're stuck, then the first hint that you should take shouldn't be the editorial. It should be the problem tags. So once you know the problem tag, that's a good enough hint. And to view the tags, you can just open the problem in an incognito window. And then you will be able to see the tag. And I would also like to add that there are some people who only practice problems topic-wise. And that is not a good thing. So there are people who learn DP from a blog or graph from a blog. And then they will see some problem links that are there in that blog and they will only solve those problems. So that's the only way they practice some problems. So in this thing, what's happening is that the moment you click on a link, you already know the tag. Like if you are reading a blog about DP, then obviously if you click the link of a problem from that blog, then obviously it's a DP problem. And again, you're limiting your thinking scope and you're having kind of like a tunnel vision. So there can be a lot of different types of approaches that can be there for that problem, but you would not think about all of them. You will only think about the DP's solutions. So you will try to think how to define the states, etc. So that is not a good thing. That is not something that you can do in an actual contest. That is not something that you can do in a coding test or in an interview. So that's why, along with topic-wise practice, it is also necessary to solve a lot of random problems. How do you solve random problems? Simply go to the code forces problem set, take a problem difficulty, and then randomly pick any problem and start solving it. So if you have turned off the problem tags also, then you won't have any hint about what this problem is about. Okay, moving on to number two, practice easy problems also. So I see a lot of LinkedIn posts and I see a lot of people advising to other people that you should not solve easy problems because you can already solve easy problems. Like if you are able to solve A and B on code forces regularly, then you should be practicing C problems only. But I do not agree with that. So a lot of people do not like to waste their time in practicing problems that they can already solve. But I'm not one of them. I think there are numerous advantages of solving easy problems. And throughout my journey, I've always solved a lot of easy problems along with the hard problems. So I've always maintained a balance. And the advantages of solving easy problems is that it really improves your speed. So maybe you can solve the A problem in every contest, but can you solve those in 3 minutes? Can you solve those in 2 minutes? If you see my screencast, there are a lot of people who keep on asking me, how do I know the solution to a problem immediately when I see them? So it's because I have a lot of speed training, and you cannot improve your speed just by solving a lot of hard problems. So to improve your speed, it is necessary to solve a lot of easy problems as well. So like if I can solve 1600 difficulty problems easily, then I will also practice a lot of 1200, 1100, 1300 problems as well, so that I can learn how to solve the same problems quickly. And the moment I finish reading a problem statement, the solution should automatically come to my mind. So that's what we're aiming for. And the advantage of improving speed is that you can solve problems quickly in a contest. So obviously that gives you less penalty and better ranks and better ratings. But apart from that, even during practice, if you're faster, then in the same amount of time, let's say you dedicate 2 hours to your CP practice every day. So what will happen is, instead of solving just 2 problems in those 2 hours, you will be able to solve 3 problems or even 4 problems in those 2 hours. And that will make your practice routine much more efficient. So that was the second trick. And let me know if you already applied those tricks to your practice schedule. Let me know in the comment section. And subscribe for more videos about competitive programming, screencast, and tricks and tips like this, and also about SD placements and guidance, etc., which I'm going to start very soon. And best of luck, and wish you a high rating. Thank you for watching.